Hello everyone, and welcome to this episode of History Saver right here on YouTube. And today we will be digging into a part of American history that is some of the most brutal, devastating, and tragic hours within our history. So stay tuned as we dig in to this episode at Fort Mims. On the afternoon of August the 30th, 1813, Muscogee Creek warriors lay in this ravine behind me, waiting for a certain moment. A certain moment of the afternoon that would turn the history books inside out as one of the most tragic, devastating, and brutal afternoons in American history and Native American history. The Muscogee Creeks were a people in South Alabama that lived on this land. They had their villages wrapped around this place, or towns wrapped around this place, and they loved the area. As white settlers moved in, the Creeks began to get a little hostile. Their land was being approached on by the Federal Road, which is a road that traveled through South Alabama, that was a means of travel for settlers. Mail would travel down this road, supplies would travel down this road, and it was a main source of transportation during the time. Now, as that Federal Road was built, their lands were encroached on, they were attacked time and time again, and they began to get very hostile, began to get tired of this, and so the Creeks broke off into a confederacy. The confederacy was split into two. You had the White Creeks, which were for peace. They didn't want war. They believed that there were other means of handling the situation. And then you had the other faction, which was the Red Sticks. Now, the Red Sticks were the ones who were very tired of what was going on, and they saw no other means than to take action. Now, in order to understand the events that transpired in this location on the afternoon of August the 30th, 1813, we must travel back a little bit and see some of the other factors leading up to the massacre here at Fort Mims. Months prior, the Creeks made their way into Spanish-held Pensacola, Florida. In Pensacola, they gathered supplies from the Spanish, such as guns, ammunition, food, and just all other tons of supplies in preparation to fight back. Now, word of this was received, and a group of militia led by a man by the name of Sam Dale led his troops into a place called Burnt Corn Creek months prior to the events here at Fort Mims. At Burnt Corn Creek, they caught up with the Red Sticks as they made their way across a little creek down a small road, and they ambushed them. The Creeks fought back. There was deaths on both sides. There was not a lot of death, however, but it was just enough to anger both factions. In retaliation for these events at Burnt Corn Creek, the Muscogee Creeks then made a decision. It was time to do something else. And those events led us here on August the 30th of 1813 to Fort Mims.
Thank you.
Fort Mims was a wooden stockade, much like the recreation of the stockade that you see behind me. And these walls lined around just a short acre of field here in Tensaw, Alabama. The stockade was built in 1813 around the home of a man by the name of Samuel Mims. Samuel Mims was a pretty prosperous man here in the area. And with the events that were unfolding with the Creek Indians and the hostilities that had began, a lot of the settlers were in panic. So Mims decided to help out in the building of this fortification or wooden stockade around his home. Mims' home was situated in the center of the stockade. This is a representation of what the fort would have looked like in 1813. As you can see, a blockhouse was in this location, and another blockhouse was being constructed within this wall area. The barracks were here, there was a cabin here, tents here and here, cabin there, militia tents there, two cabins here, another cabin here. This is the spot of the loom house, and various other cabins lined the interior. At the end of the west gate, you can see there was two different structures in that portion. This was the spot of Samuel Mims and his home. This was the home that this fort was built around. It was a frame construction home. It had two porches, and many of the people inside of this fortification took refuge here in this area during the attack. This fort was loaded with about just over 500 women, men, and children. Regular army troops were here, although not in mass, and there were around 260 militia troops here, of the Mississippi Militia and the Home Guard Militia in the Tensaw area. The fort during the day was alive with kids playing, men playing cards, talking, daily duties of tending to the little farm that was here and the garden and crops in that field. There was a barn outside of this stockade where they housed the horses. They were tended to. There was a few slaves inside of the stockade as well that helped tend to whatever needs that man needed to be done here. This fort was not just filled with white settlers. It was also filled with Muscogee Creeks as well. Many of the families in this area during that time were half-breeds. Half-breeds meant that most of them were white and Creek. So the Native Americans during this time that started building hostilities were kin to a lot of the individuals who actually settled inside of this fortification. And that created another crisis for the settlers here. Now the fort was situated, they had a kitchen here, they had a blockhouse, which was a wooden structure that provided protection from with loopholes in the bottom and the top, and that would allow for the men to fire out of that fortification into whatever enemy may be attacking at that time. This is the blockhouse. The blockhouse is a wooden stockade structure built within the fort walls that allowed a defensive position. On the side of the blockhouse were these holes. These holes were made for firing muskets from inside out into the attackers. Inside of this blockhouse is very dark. There would have been a candle in here for light, perhaps, but during the heat of battle, even at noontime, this blockhouse was pitch black, as you see here.
Now, as we walk through here, I want you to imagine rushing in this door as you hear Native Americans rushing in with their war cries. The rustic warriors are rushing through that gate towards your position. You have to defend your family. Men would come inside of this blockhouse, stand on this platform, and fire out of these loopholes. There were firing positions on the bottom floor, and there would have been a ladder right here that would go up into the roof. As you can see, it's pitch black. The camera's not showing up much inside of this structure at all at this present time. During the 12 o'clock hour on August the 30th, 1813, the conditions would have been the same. There were two of these here, but one was not completed. The one that was completed found the men inside making shot from whatever they could. They were having to make shot as the battle ensued. They had this door closed, and it was pitch black inside with them trying to find their way to survive the massacre that ensued. Now, the other structures inside of this fortification were cabins. There was a barracks building, although very small. Tents were set up along the back wall, and those tents belonged to the militia. The commanders of the militia had cabins as well. Those cabins were situated along this back wall immediately to my left. Now, life here was very, very hot. It's August time, but they had grew accustomed to the southern weather that was here inside of the fort. And many of the people here on August the 30th, 1813, were just going about their daily lives. In this area that you see in front of you, this was in the approximate location of the Samuel Mims home. The Samuel Mims home was situated in the middle of the stockade, and in this area would have been the women and children and men of the fort on that August 30th afternoon as they gathered for the noontime meal. Now, as they gathered in this area for their noontime meal, and the dinner bell rang, they all of a sudden heard screaming. Not screaming in the form of fear, but screaming in the form of revenge. The spot you see in front of you right here played a major part in the battle at Fort Mims. Because at noon, as the dinner bell rang, this is where it rang from. This was the original spot of the dinner bell that signaled the attack of Fort Mims for the Muscogee Creeks. The Red Sticks rushed through the gate upon the ringing of this bell that once stood here. And as they rushed through the gates, all hell broke loose. A couple of days prior to the fort being attacked here, two slaves had come into the fortification. They come into around this area and told the officers here that there were Indians on the way here. Instead of heeding their word, the officers tied those slaves up to maybe a tree just like this, and they whooped them. And punishment because they thought they were lying to them. In this area is where all that happened. So where we are standing right now was the part of the events that transpired on August the 30th. On the morning of August the 30th, a militia guard came into this fortification, found one of the officers, told him Native Americans is on their way. Now, being kind of drunk and hungover, the officer did not heed the word.
When that officer did not heed that word, that warning from that soldier, that would cost many lives here at the fort. He told him, they're on the way. They're planning to attack. He just shrugged him off and said, you're lying. Don't worry about it. Go on about your day. We'll take care of it if something happens. Well, that wasn't taken care of. Leading the forces on the attack against the fort here was a man by the name of William Weatherford, or Red Eagle, or in the Creek language, Lummi Jotty. William Weatherford and Peter McQueen gathered troops directly outside of this fort. Those warriors, the troops of the Red Stick Army of the Creeks, rushed into the fortification of Fort Mims. And here, over 500 women, children, and men lost their lives.
Across this field, the Red Stick warriors charged as the dinner bell rang for the fort's noontime meal. The inhabitants of this fortification had no clue of the events that were about to transpire. As the cries went up, an officer made his way to this gate. This gate was wide open at the time. It was not closed. It had not been closed for several days. As he made his way to this gate, he put his hand on this door and he tried to close it. As he tried to close this gate, he noticed below there was sand preventing this door from closing. So as that officer is standing here trying to pull this gate closed, he was cut down. This is where that officer fell. As that officer fell, natives began to close in around this wall. As they closed in around this wall, gunshots began to make their way through. There was loopholes cut within this stockade.
The natives would stick their muskets through these loopholes and fire into the inhabitants of the fort.
Women, children, men, this wall is where many of those shots of death came from. As the natives ran across this field you see before you, this at the time was a potato field. And now as they ran across this field, this is the sight that they saw, an open gate. As they closed in around the walls of the perimeter, started firing through the loopholes, they also charged through this gate. From this gate, they made their way inside the fortification, the Mims home, right in this general vicinity, the cabins of the officers and tents of the officers in this vicinity. And on this side, more cabins, more tents of the officers. The loom house was immediately to your front. There was a kitchen in here, straight somewhere in front of us where we are right now. As they made their way inside, they cut down women, children, men. Children would climb trees just to get away from the Native Americans that were attacking. There was also reports that babies were struck among the trees, killed. Now, before the battle, Red Eagle had told his warriors, do not harm the babies. Do not harm the children. Leave the women alone. They didn't heed his word. They didn't listen. And in the midst of that battle, William Weatherford, Lummi Jotty, or Red Eagle, left. He couldn't take the carnage that was ensuing before him. So he left the battle in this midst. The warriors, along with Peter McQueen, continue the fight inside of this fort. As that battle ensued, as the Native Americans began charging through this front gate, men would take cover behind whatever they could, just to get shots off, just to have some cover from the bullets. They had nowhere to go. These men, women, and children would gather behind trees, behind buildings, praying that their life would be spared. Almost none of them made it out alive. This back gate is the west gate of the fortification. This gate was also taken over. Men at this position were taken down by Creek warriors just on the outside of this wall. The Creek warriors had this place surrounded. The blockhouse that you see down was taken over. People were rushing inside of that blockhouse as the defenders attempted to fire back at the Creek warriors. That blockhouse would also fall. After just a few hours of hard fighting here at Fort Mims, the defenders here were offered a brief time of rest, a time to get their wounded somewhere hopefully safe. The Creek warriors withdrew, they too taking care of their wounded. There were around 100 Creek warriors that we know of that fell here at this fort, as opposed to the over 500 women, men, children, and military troops that fell here. Now,
As they tended to their wounded along these grounds, the men and the women prayed it was over. The blood here inside the fort ran ankle deep. The carnage was devastating. Every structure was on fire, and there was nothing but smoke and death all around. All of a sudden, another cry went up. The warriors again came back through the gates. As they rushed back through these gates behind me, they attacked the fort a second time. Now, these survivors, the few that was left, made their way to this spot right here. This was the section called Patrick's Loom House. In this spot stood a loom house, a spot for helping make clothes. It was also used for other things. But the few surviving members of the fortification here ran into where this structure once stood. They were barricaded inside of that structure and burned alive. A few were able to cut their way through this back wall behind this loom house and escape into the woods behind it. From there, they made their way, or most of them did, towards the river that is only about 300 yards from this location. The structure that once stood in this spot that offered a way to weave clothes out of loom was now the ultimate resting place for the few remaining survivors that were left here at Fort Mims at the end of the battle. This point marked the end of a brutal massacre and the most devastating period that our history had ever seen up until this point. This spot marked the end of the worst massacre in American history up until 9/11. In this spot stood the well of Fort Mims. This well was perhaps the most important spot of this site. After the battle was over, it took 2 weeks for troops to get here. It took 2 weeks for anyone to get here. When they arrived, they found the ground around this site littered with hundreds of dead. Those dead were bloated in the August sun, stank profusely, and so they threw many of those
into this well. This well served as a mass grave and a final resting place for many of those who perished here at Fort Mims.
The massacre that took place here at Fort Mims was one of the worst massacres to ever occur on American soil. It was a pivotal part in American and Native American history. The events here shaped the events that were to come over the next few years. The events here at Fort Mims led to the Creek Indian Wars. Other battles were fought at places such as Loosahatchee, Holy Ground, Horseshoe Bend, and it also helped lead to the Trail of Tears.